Hello, I'm Mario.
And I'm Mike.
Welcome to the first edition of Mario Likes Movies Presents.
Tonight we're putting Mary Horror on the table.
With us tonight we have Brian Weber, the writer, producer, director of Mary Horror, and we have Sheriff Tom, Joe Parascand, also the co-producer.
Before we start, check out the trailer for Mary Horror.
I do have a gift for you. It belonged to a distant relative of yours. Her name was Rebecca. She was persecuted during the Salem witch trials.
You know, you have to be careful with that book, Mary.
Mom, I know.
I love you. I'll see you later.
Why don't you read about the Salem witches thing that your grandma gave you? The book you always had?
Yeah.
Come on, it's who you are.
My life was once peaceful and innocent, just like everyone expects life to be. But now I'm different.
If you don't get rid of that book, bad things are gonna happen.
Wait!
A family brutally murdered in their own home. There is one known survivor, the daughter, Mary Horowitz.
We're gonna take you to a place where you'll be protected, well cared for.
Your bestseller idea.
Well, at this time, she's being held in protective custody at an undisclosed psychiatric hospital. And Mayor Grafton and I assure everybody she's going to receive the best treatment possible.
No! 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 Do a little story on the Horowitz case, then help me out some questions I have.
It's a book of spells, but you need to practice to get the results you want.
Get out of here. It isn't safe anymore. Fucking zombie?
Do as I say. What are you? Run for your life! Jesus Christ!
The fuck was that, Paul?
It's weird. I don't know.
You know what it might be? Those big bird shits. I've heard when they shit from space, it falls and sounds like an explosion.
So, tell us about Mary Horror.
Well, Mary Horror is a new horror film that I directed, I wrote, and I edited and produced. And it's actually about a girl who comes back to life and kills everybody who wronged her. And you actually see, you know, who wronged her in the beginning of the film. But
so is that the story you were trying to tell, the revenge tale?
Yes. I really thought a female lead would be great to, you know, be a slasher and be a lead in the horror film, because I don't feel like that's done
usually,
enough. Really.
They usually play the victim or the heroine, but never all fine.
Yeah, it was hard to actually have her play all those roles in the film, but I think Susie did a great job as Mary, and
absolutely.
It was her character really, you know, builds throughout the whole film, so you just see her become
the
this
different
person.
Levels. Yeah.
Yeah.
What inspired you with the movie to make it this?
Well, going to a lot of these horror conventions like Chiller Theater and Monster Mania in New Jersey, you know, seeing the fan base, seeing all those people that are so dedicated to horror films, I just couldn't believe it. And it horror just has like a long-lasting life. And I love 80s horror films. And like The People Under the Stairs, one of my favorite movies. And I also love Alfred Hitchcock, so I kind of combine those two elements together. And
perfect elements.
Yeah, I had a blast making the movie, so it's great.
How did you prepare for it? Like, wearing all those hats, like, it had to be.
Well,
it's a lot to it.
Yeah, it's a big undertaking, and we only had a certain amount of money to really work with, and it was, you know, it took me about 3 months to write the script, 3 months to film it, and 3 months to edit. But about 5 years ago, you know, I came up with the idea of driving. Actually, a lot of my ideas come in while I'm driving. But it actually was like a short music video idea I had, where a girl runs out of her house from a killer, and then all of a sudden she turns around, she has the knife in her, and she really stabbed herself, and she killed herself, and she was really the killer. But it turned into Mary Horror after like lots of ideas just coming to me, after, you know, year after year, and. I saw that yellow house and it just blew me away. So I used to drive by it all the time and I couldn't believe how this house should be in a movie. If you see it in real life, it's unbelievable, because it's like, it's just this house in the middle of this giant field. It just looks like the Psycho house.
And it's very yellow.
It's very yellow. It's actually a historical house in New Jersey. And the people are super nice that run it and everything, let us shoot whenever we wanted. It has no lights on the house at all. So you have to light the whole house from the outside, but just, you know, I just felt like there needed to be a horror film out there that had like that had a female lead as a killer, and I wanted to tell a story of how someone became, you know, a monster.
Speaking of inspiration, Sheriff Tom, the character, did you have any set motivations for this character? Did you read the script and see how you wanted to portray this guy?
Actually, in the script, there was a line actually that one of the people says as when they're describing me, and they're saying, oh, the Sheriff Tommy thinks he's RoboCop. Well, the thing is, he's got a very high opinion of himself. He thinks he's a badass guy. He thinks he's Clint Eastwood, basically, and yet all the townspeople think he's Andy Griffith. So pretty much there's a paradox there, but he's, of course, he's a bad guy in this, a crooked sheriff, so... Just think of, let's say, maybe a bad Clint Eastwood is what give me a little bit of idea of what he might do.
Sheriff Tom, he's a big character in the film, of course, main player. What was your direction towards him? What was your vision for the character coming into it?
Well, you know, I would exactly what Joe said. I feel like he was RoboCop and Clint Eastwood combined, and I wanted people to think he was, like, you know, full of himself. And it was this Sheriff Tom, you know, he talks in the third person a lot. So I think, you know...
I noticed that, yeah.
And I think, you know, he gets what he wants, and if someone's in his way, he really doesn't like it too much. And I think he's one of my favorite characters in the movie, definitely, because he evolves throughout the film, you know, and becomes kind of his own, you know, another person in a way by the end of it, really.
Yeah, as a freak, kind of freaks out, and you know, if you can imagine him going off the charts,
yeah. Almost take your own revenge in a way.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely.
And try to get, you know,
he becomes obsessed himself.
With direction, you're a producer, director. You wrote and you edited this. What were the challenges? Like, that has to be.
I was like actually really used to doing it, because I did that with all my other films, and. It was actually kind of hard for me to have a cameraman, because I did a lot of that too. And in the film, Ryan Coyle is the cameraman, and you know, I also grab the camera here and there, and among other people, Jason Crow too. And I like, you know, different people holding the camera, because I think it gives it like a little different look here and there, and different vision. But, you know, doing all those things, it allowed me to really bring out what I was trying to portray, you know, for the movie to be. And, you know, I really think, in order to really tell the story right, I think I had to do all those things. I enjoy editing the most, I think. Editing and directing the most. The writing part, the script part, I I struggle with that, because I'm not a writer in any way. I just have like a million ideas, and I try to put them into something. So the script part I struggle with, a lot of sleepless nights. Actually, the editing as well, and Jason Crow and Ryan Coyle also helped me with the editing.
Absolutely.
And there's lots of sleepless nights, and and Jason was right there with me, really editing a lot of the after effects, and it was, and just, you know, I felt like the movie was my vision, and I had to really have a hand in everything. So, but I enjoy it. I like doing that. I'm going to do it again. So.
Absolutely.
Sounds good. Captain of your ship, right? Speaking of costs, what was the budget of Mary Horror?
Well, the budget was $5,000, a little less maybe. I'm not really sure the exact number, but I would say somewhere between $4,500 and $5,000.
That's pretty good for the finished product, considering.
Yeah, I think it's unheard of. I think it's, I don't see a lot of people making a movie like this for that amount of money and having the people that we had in it and the actors that we had in it. I mean, it takes a lot of people working for free. It's a passion of everybody that's involved. And if they're loving what they're doing and coming to the set and every day enjoying it. I mean, we shot for 3 months, and I had the same people there every day. So.
I mean, they had to like doing it. I mean,
yeah, they didn't have to show up. There was no contract, obligation, or anything for the, especially the crew.
Yeah.
So we had a great crew, and everyone worked for free, and it was an amazing experience for everybody. We became like a family.
Absolutely.
But, you know, and really, you know, I'm hoping to make the next movie for even less and make it look even better.
Oh, $5,000 in 3 months. That's really good.
Yeah.
I gotta ask, when did you shoot the film and where?
We shot it March 1st to May 31st of last year, of 2011, and most of it shot in Burnsville, New Jersey, which is central North Jersey, and. We shot some things in Franklin Township, which is kind of close to here in Edison.
Yeah.
And that's where the Yellow House is.
I actually know the Yellow House.
Yeah, you go by. And I went up to Salem and shot some exteriors and stuff like that. Went down to Atlantic City, shot a scene there, but I try to keep it all Jersey. So I think Jersey is very photogenic. So.
It definitely is.
Yeah.
I've seen parts of Jersey where it looks like you could shoot New York City or you can shoot the south of France. Like it's New Jersey.
Oh, yeah. Definitely.
I want to kind of represent my town because the town I live in, I've lived there forever, and the town's so great, and I got, you know, the whole town was involved in making the film. So
that's great.
That was the one thing I noticed. I kind of like that. You could tell that everybody was around from there.
Oh, yeah. So. I had everybody. Librarians, the mayor playing the... homeless man screaming Mary Horror. His wife was Dr. Baxter.
Absolutely.
And, you know, just, I had all these extras just come out of nowhere for the old Cut Square scene. So it was great. It's definitely a group effort, not just me. So.
Speaking of group effort and everybody wanting to contribute, did you have any kind of difficulties filming with all those things put together?
Yeah, there were some difficulties. Sometimes we got pushed out of our location. Down in Atlantic City, we got pushed out of a psychic store or whatever it's called. Psychic reading. And, you know, I was promised a location. I got there, and there was some worry of them not getting business. So they decided to kick me out of the location,
and hence they lost business.
And they lost business because Patricia Quinn was in the scene, and they didn't really know who she was. And then they realized who she was, but in 5 minutes I had to come up with another location because she was coming there. And we decided to shoot it on the bench in Atlantic City Boardwalk with the seagulls and everything. And it really came out great. I think it was meant to happen.
Equipment wise, what did you shoot on?
Well, we shot on a Sony HDR AX2000 with memory cards, and it was a great camera, really. It was Ryan Coyles, who was the cameraman, so he knew that camera very well. It was like his little baby, and we had a three piece light set that was given to me by my friend for free as well. And sometimes we use work lights here and there, and some gels and everything. But the lighting was definitely very difficult because it was always very dark out. We were shooting late nights. Usually there was no light anywhere or electricity. So we were running cords for miles just to light something.
Like a nightmare.
Yeah. The graveyard was really hard.
But that one time we had, oh God, we must have come about 10 feet short.
Oh.
So we had to, like, let's see what the cable stretcher on this. You know.
The graveyard, we had to run at least a mile, I think, to get up to where we dug. We actually dug in a real graveyard off to the side and everything, but that was, it's pitch dark. Well, and the light shut off one time, and it was in darkness. And the house had no lights, and the high school had no lights outside for some reason.
So that was a big issue, the lights?
Yeah. We'll do better next time, definitely. But I think for what it, if you experienced it, it came out really well, the lights. So I like the gels and the different colors, because actually it's supposed to be like a heaven and hell kind of thing in the movie where Mary comes down to go to the football game, and it's like there's a yellow like fire, and then there's like the blue, so that's supposed to be like a heaven and hell kind of thing. So
I was wondering about that actually.
Yeah, I love lights. I love the colors.
So you like different schemes and everything.
Oh yeah, definitely.
So speaking of the film, you have a lot of cameos in this movie. Could you tell us about those?
Yeah, well. Cameos are tough because
they're tough to get.
Yeah, they are. But we met some really nice people, like Ernie Hudson, which is probably the most well-known person in our movie.
Yeah.
I went up to him at a convention and I said, "I got this great idea. I would love you to, just, you know, do a real quick phone call cameo." And he goes, "Well, what do you want me to say?" And I said, "Who are you trying to call?" And he said, they just started laughing, him and his manager or assistant or whoever it was, and he got right up and he did it. And for free, for no problem, he just said, "Don't put me in the main credits," whatever I said. So I respected his wish and I did that, and it's the best like 2 seconds of the movie. but Patricia Quinn has a full scene and not just a cameo, and she was amazing. I gave her a script at a convention as well. She read it, she liked it. And we ended up meeting her at a Rocky Horror Con in Atlantic City. Lloyd Kaufman is an amazing guy, and he did his part at a convention as well. I just went up to him. Who else? Deanna Russo, she's in Rest Stop and the new Knight Rider. I actually went to high school with her, and I asked her. She was in Jersey for the first time in 5 years.
Wow,
and
what are you asking that, huh?
And she came, and I'll do it, no problem.
Wow.
And she did it for that for free, too, and... Who else do we have? Jason Marsden is in it. He does the voice of Max Goof in the Goofy movie. He's also in Full House, Step by Step. He was in Boy Meets World. He's actually a friend of mine, and because he did a music video for my band a long time ago, and he's a great guy. And all the cameos, just I try to separate them and make them, you know, funny and.
Well, they were pretty funny in their specific ways.
And I love Jason Marsden's reveal when he takes the mask off. And I had this crazy dream of him being like Crazy Eddie and selling Mary Horror products. And I called him up and I'm like, you gotta do this. And he was kind of hesitant at first. And he's like, "Oh, I'm just gonna do like a phone thing." I said, "Okay, that's fine." But then all of a sudden I get an email. He goes, "Check this out," whatever. And I click on it and it's him doing the whole thing. So he went above and beyond what I thought.
I actually like that part, the Mary Horror advertising.
Yeah, it's Mary Horror night. Yeah. Come on down, Old God Square, or whatever. You know. And he did the thing with the stuffed monkey, which I love that part. But he did a great job. Everybody just, you know, it was weird how it all like came together. And I'm hoping for some really great cameos in the next film too. So it's gonna be good. I mean, I think
absolutely.
All the real, you know, regular actors were fantastic too. Most of all from New Jersey.
Yeah, I would hope so.
Well, Joe and Katie Farley and Susie Decker and you know, Sean and MJ too. They were also cameos in the film.
The truck drivers, right?
Yeah, they're Cool Duder on. Sean is Cool Duder on YouTube, and he is the biggest fan of this movie. So he loves it. He asked me every day about it. We became friends over, and he's just such a talented guy. That was the first thing we ever shot in the car, and that was the first night of filming. And he just set the standard for the movie. He just like I was like I felt like I was shooting a real movie finally in my life.
Yeah.
And they do a brilliant thing though, those two together. And they improvised some stuff, and it was just hilarious. We were dying laughing, but it was freezing cold.
I saw it. You could see the breath a little bit in those scenes.
Yeah, last year was March 1st. It was way different than this year's March 1st.
And
yeah,
Sean being in California, he was freezing. So, but I'm hoping to have him back in another film. I actually wrote, I'm writing a comedy with him as a lead. Eventually, we're going to hopefully do that. So,
guys, who are some of your influences in the movie industry?
I would say my first influences of all really were back the old 1930s and 40s horror movies. You know, all black and white, you know, it made you almost...
the classics.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And back in, you know, some of them are supposed to represent, well, the 1880s. Well, I guess being that it was in black and white, it had a more authentic look to it. You almost believe that, well, that's how it looked back then. There was no color.
And, yeah, well, just grays and blacks.
Yeah,
and brown.
Yeah, exactly. And then it was very more, very suspenseful, too, a lot of those movies. They may not have showed the gore you have today, but probably, yeah. Then we go all the way into the B-movie period, I guess, a lot of the sci-fis in the 50s, love those. And then, you know, we fast forward into the 70s there, really, I started watching, once I was a teenager, I was starting watching everything there was, back to Humphrey Bogart, The Godfather, I mean, love, you know, Pacino, De Niro, I mean, all the way up, any of the heroes and anti-heroes, Clint Eastwood,
yeah,
mentioned before, and yeah, and like I said, that was pretty much gave me an idea of, well, if I ever did get into this field, you know, they certainly provided great examples, you know, for all of us, I'm sure.
Definitely, yeah. Yeah.
Well, what really influenced me was 80s movies, because I'm an 80s baby, you know, born in 1980. Back to the Future is my favorite movie. I love Robert Zemeckis as a director. He tells a great story, and I actually, you know, I started going to these conventions because I wanted to get my Back to the Future poster signed by everybody in the movie. And I have almost everybody but Leah Thompson, so she's out there, you know, come to the East Coast convention. Everyone else is super nice, great people and everything, but I love Alfred Hitchcock as well, and North by Northwest is one of my favorite films. I think it's way ahead of its time. You know, and I like Jerry Lewis, and I like very different people. Like Robert Rodriguez, I think he's amazing. Desperado, that movie.
Yeah.
The camera angles in it are fantastic, and the way he uses the music with the film. So I have, like, all different crazy influences, but, you know, everybody really inspires me just to, like, I just see these great movies, and I want to make something that's great, and so it keeps me moving.
What do you guys hope to achieve with Mary Carr? Like, which way do you...
Well, you know, we just want to get the word out and people to realize that, you know, you can make a movie with any amount of money, really. I would just take any kind of camera anywhere and just try to make, you know, a little short film, or, you know, if you want to be a filmmaker, I mean, that's...
Always trying to tell the story.
Yeah, I mean, the story is, to me, the, you know, backbone of making a film. And we really just want to get the word out that, you know, we're here, and, like, we're ready to make lots of movies and have fun with it, and...
It's only the beginning.
It is. It's only the beginning. It's kind of the launching pad of what, you know, I want to do. So, I mean, I want to make this a career and really just enjoy everything, you know, along the way, just, you know, with the journey. So, I mean, what do you hope to accomplish with this as an actor?
Well, first, I wanted to say that it's certainly been a great opportunity just to be in the project there, and let me first say that when it had first begun, the script had the sheriff actually getting killed about halfway through the movie. And as we were doing our shooting, I guess a decision was made that no, we really would not like that to happen, let's extend the role, and so I lived on.
He became such a big part of the film, so I felt like we had to do it. And actually, Arlene and Dave, Arlene Coyle and Dave Zamora, they're one of the executive producers. That was their idea. They said, we think the sheriff should live, and it kept sticking in my head. And I'm
very
like,
nice of everybody.
It makes perfect sense.
I certainly have enjoyed, like I said, it's just a wonderful opportunity to, you know, to go through that. Once again, here I am. Playing a bad guy.
You did it
back
quite
when
well,
I,
though.
Well, thank you.
So what I think we're really trying to do is to make a movie for the horror fans, like for these amazing, dedicated fans that go out to all these conventions and they see, you know, they love the people even from the 80s, from the 70s.
Yep. Diehards.
There's diehard horror fans, and that's, you know, I wanted to make a movie that really is different too, where you see this person become the monster instead of the monster already being there, and her journey.
What lessons did you learn from Mary Horror that you could maybe use for future projects?
Or run away from in future projects?
Well, I learned that lighting is very difficult, especially at pitch darkness. And, you know, I think it takes like a great group of people to really make a good movie, and we had a great group. So the lesson I really learned is just to get a great group of people to make something, and you'll make something fantastic. And find people that are into your idea and are passionate about it, just like you are.
Yeah, as an actor, what did you get from this?
Well, one thing I learned, I guess, was probably the most I was pushed, if you will, I guess, in terms of long days, you know, long nights of shooting there. And bottom line is, you want to make sure you get your sleep when you can before that, so you're ready to go the next day. But I remember a funny scene where it came out funny, if you will, where we're my character and my boss, the mayor's character, were joking around. It was around 4 in the morning, and I think that's right, daylight savings or whatever, so it made it 1 hour even later. But bottom line is, we had been going since, like, I guess, 9 or 10 in the morning the previous day. So by that time, we were delirious. We didn't have to, let's say, get in the emotional state of laughing.
We just
looked at each other, and we just cracked up and said, this is going to work easily.
And we were saying, it's all good, Joe, it's all good, and we were cracking up.
And that's one of my sayings, and I've kept it alive for 20 years.
The one thing we did was crazy, which I'll never do again. Well, maybe I will, but it was fun. But we did 30 scenes of the movie in 3 days.
Oh, yeah?
In that house, the house had like 40 or 50 rooms, and we filmed tons of stuff in the house, outside. But we I had to combine all different parts of the film into three days and 30 scenes.
Made use of every room in that place, practically.
Sounds like a lot.
I had all different actors there, all different times, people waiting around, you know, doing this and that.
Yeah, that's right. It's 10 pizzas. Have it over by 3 o'clock, please.
But it was like a marathon, you know. So it was, we would shoot from 8 a.m. to like 10 or 11 until we got kicked out.
Absolutely.
So we actually were supposed to stay longer, and they kicked us out early. So I was like,
keep that promise.
I had about five. I shot that scene with Dr. Hess and Nurse Cloris when the lights go out. I shot that scene in 5 minutes because we had 5 minutes left, and I had to get that in. That was the last scene.
One take.
Yeah.
Almost.
It was crazy. It was we did the psych ward stuff in the ballroom. We did Mary's house with the killing going on. We had the end of the film we did there with her in the house and everything. And
in 3 days.
Yeah. And Dr. Baxter scene talking to Mary. And
that was the marathon.
Yeah. It was great, though. It really showed it actually kind of pushed us even more to just keep going, you know.
It's always good to hear. I mean, you know, if you're on a roll, you know, might as well just keep on going with it.
Oh yeah, you gotta keep moving along and staying positive, and no matter what happens. So
what's next for Weber Pictures?
Well, for the past couple months, I've been writing the sequel to Mary Horror, and I'm pretty excited about it. I think it's fantastic. I am loving it. It kind of takes it in a different direction, and it actually shifts gears to the sheriff in the movie, Sheriff Tom, and we got him involved, and we're going to have a bunch of cameos again, and I'm actually shooting something really quick tomorrow, a little secret scene at Chiller Theater, but we're actually not going to probably shoot till July and August in the summer, and hope to have it out by like next year, so next, the March Monster Mania, hopefully it will be the unveiling of it, and I'm hoping, you know, we're working on a distribution deal right now for Mary Horror, and I actually have another comedy as well that I've been working on, and trying to change it up a little bit, but I have to always have comedy elements. But, you know, I'm actually really happy to focus more on the sheriff because I think his character has so much more going on. We get to know more about it. So what do you think? What do you think about it?
He has lots of great ideas. Basically, as when we were shooting the first film, having to plan during the week for the shoots that may come up later in the week or on the weekend, as in now, and as he's writing the sequel, usually the last phone call of the night before going to bed has been between us there. And that, oh, I got this new idea, got that, et cetera. So,
constantly.
Yes, he has a lot of great ideas.
My ideas
absolutely
don't stop, and it's very frustrating. I have to get them out somewhere. So, we've talked a lot about everything, and the direction that it's going to go is going to be bloody. It's going to be pretty classic 80s horror, and it's really just one big action-packed like horror movie. So, I'm really excited to film it, and
it's going
to
be a lot of fun.
And we're hoping to bring back a lot of the people from the first movie. And Mario's like movies is going to be in the movie, hopefully.
Oh, okay.
Going to come out and be a part of it. And I'm hoping to bring
the
people that died in the movie. I'm hoping to bring them back as other characters. And
they're dying to come back.
Well, yeah, I'm hoping to have a pretty good cast and a lot of cameos from other people again, and some of the same faces coming back. And we're just going to have another great time making another movie. And so I'm really excited with what the future is going to hold. So
can't wait.
And Mario's like movies involved.
We'll be there. Guys, we really look forward to it. And thank you for coming out and doing the interview with us.
Thanks for having us. Thanks for having us. You guys have a great website. So.
Thank you. You have a
love
great
your
movie.
Reviews.
Thank you. So we want to thank Ryan Weber and Joe Parascand again. You can catch their movie at www.maryhorror.com.
Buy your copy.
On the internet.
The internet, buy your copy.
So for the first edition of Mary Likes Movies Presents, we will see you next time.